Welcome to Sardar TV. I'm Tracy Fitzpatrick. Our guest today is Burkey Belser, managing partner and creative director of the Greenfield Belser Finn Partners Agency. He's also known as the branding boss, a pioneer in legal marketing, and a recent inductee into the Washington Art Directors Hall of Fame. He's also a sought-after speaker and has written numerous articles and books, including 25 years of legal branding. Burkey, thanks so much for being here.
It's a pleasure to be here. This should be fun.
Absolutely. So tell us, what is your background with Greenfield Belser, and what is the relationship with the Finn Partners Agency?
I wish I could tell that story in a really quick soundbite, but it's too hard. I began in 1974. I wasn't trained as a graphic designer, but I began in 1974 on my own and had $1,000 in my pocket and a credit card.
It's a lot of money back then.
More than I would have expected. It held me on for a while. And I had a job as a business development manager of a company, went out on my own, and carried a client with me, so I had some hope that I could eat. But within a year and a half, I had almost two people working for me, an accountant as half a person. And within the next few years, quite a bit more. I was married 4 years later. My wife was a litigator at the Federal Trade Commission, and I thought, that's my meal ticket. She's going to carry me through. But she quit. She wanted to work with me. And I said, okay, but we need to do this together. You need to carry your weight. And she did. And within a few more years, we had as many as 50 people working for us. So it was a very successful enterprise. That's as short as I can make that story. As we grew older and grew to that larger size, I wanted to find a home for all of the people that worked for us, particularly the people that had worked for us for 10, 15, 25 years. We've had people that have kept by our side for all that period of time. When Finn came calling, it was the easiest decision in the world. Peter had me at hello. He was charming. His values were what spoke to us. And the result was that we've now become part of Finn Partners. And it's not the end of everything. It's the beginning all over again. We have the real opportunity to learn, grow, and develop new clients. It's very exciting.
You're considered the pioneer of legal marketing. So what made your early work stand out from the staid crowd of the law?
Okay. We began with legal marketing really when it was first possible to do so in 1978. Lawyers were allowed to advertise, but none of them wanted to do so. They were embarrassed by the concept, embarrassed by the idea. They felt it was unseemly, improper. So we had a long road to hoe in order to get them to feel comfortable with the idea of legal marketing. First things we would do would be brochures, very conservative and the like. It wasn't necessarily even fun to do. But over time, we created more and more pioneering work for law firms. We did the first, as I mentioned, law firm brochure. We did the first logo. We did the first ads, real, you know, serious ads for law firms. We were even advertising in airport dioramas. We did one for a firm in Tennessee, a very established white shoe firm in Tennessee called Baker Donaldson, where we had Motley Crue on the diorama. That was just breakthrough stuff. And after a while, it became evident to people that if they wanted killer work, you pick up the phone and call Greenfield Belser. And that really led to our success. Not everybody wanted that, but over 400 law firms have.
Can you share with us a success story about one of the campaigns that you're particularly proud of?
Sure. People always point to Nutrition Facts, which we designed the whole labeling system that's on 6.5 billion food packages in the United States. It's actually made its way around the world as a de facto standard. The New York Times called it the most printed and viewed piece of art in the world. But I'm proud of that, of course. Very few people know that we did the drug facts on all over-the-counter drugs and the energy guide that's on all your major appliances, but that is not core to our work. You know, I could also say that we're proud for pioneering legal services marketing, because prior to us, it did not exist. However, the things that I like are the campaigns, like we launched DC Film Fest with a series of posters and promotional material for them. That's now almost 20 years old. It was a huge success. That was art, pure and simple. And what I like about that as a designer, and this is where you really touch the soul of a designer, what I loved about that was that it was smart, and I think people describe our work this way. It was smart, it was intellectual, it created a kind of inner smile, but it also had a strong idea behind it, and it was very compelling work to see. It created an emotion. That's what I'm proud of.
How do you define branding?
There's really no easy definition for branding. People think of it as a logo alone related to the cattle branding, but the definition is really much more complex. I have created a definition that's a brand is a distinctive identity based on a promise of value that's different from any other. Now, I've memorized that, but you won't, and that's hard, and it's hard for people to remember that. The easiest way to think of it is brand is personality generally. I love a quote from Andy Warhol, who said, "I'm superficial, but I'm deeply superficial." And I thought, there's your definition of branding right there. It's taking everything from inside an organization and then splashing it up onto the page.
Okay, you've worked with so many different brands over the years. What, according to you, are the building blocks of a strong brand?
I have an unusual answer to that question. That what comes to my mind is Pygmalion. It's not what people think when they think about a brand, but if you go back, it started with Bernard Shaw's play, and then it became My Fair Lady. But if you think about Eliza, you don't think of her normally as a brand, but she became a brand. She was given a look and feel by the women in the film. She was given a voice by Rex Harrison to become that person. And then her own personality and commitment to that voice, to the work that she was doing, that they were doing together, created really a brand. And that's, if we put it in human terms, I think it makes it easier to understand what a brand really is.
Can you explain five essential components of a good branding strategy that can help leaders create a successful brand?
Good question. I believe that it all begins with organizational leadership. That's where everything starts and ends. There are, of course, individual components of the brand, but let's say that the very first one is leadership, that I need strong leadership to hold the brand together. Secondly, I need courage and this may not be the kind of components that you would imagine, but without courage, there's not going to be a brand that has any impact at all on the marketplace, because the brand should make you a little bit weak at the knees in order to have an impact on the market. Third is research. You really need to know the facts. One of the things about our particular clients is they're very, in fact, really all of them, they're very left-brain individuals. They want to know the value that they're getting from this, and they have opinions, and opinions can easily become fact in their mind, and so our goal is to provide the facts in return to them about their firm, about their organization, about the marketplace, et cetera, so that they'll understand that. Creativity is key. There's no point in creating a brand with correct strategy and data, all the data in the world, if it's not creative and going to have, once again, an impact on folks. And then finally, this may be ultimately the most important thing, is stay the course. Once a brand has been developed and created, it's too easy to abandon it with the next change in leadership, with the next marketing director, with the next managing partner or CEO. It's important to keep own the brand and cleave to what we've decided and agreed to is the brand and brand strategy.
And what's on your checklist while you're doing the brand research?
Well, we're interested in several things. We're certainly interested in what's going on with the seller. How is their service being delivered now? How is it being communicated and marketed? And what are their clients? How do their clients perceive them in the marketplace? And then when we come back to it, all together, are they communicating who they really are? So our first job is to find out answers to those questions. We're also, of course, extremely interested in the mind of the buyer. What does the buyer want? What are they looking for? And frequently there's a disconnect with the seller and the buyer, so that alignment has to occur. I certainly will admit that I'm always afraid that we fail to ask all the questions that we should ask. We've done it for a long time. I've interviewed 5,000 buyers of legal services and professional services. I've interviewed
just as many lawyers, accountants, consultants, and others. So we understand the market extraordinarily well. We understand buyer and seller. But creating that alignment that's unique to the personality of that particular organization, that's what we're looking for.
Does the research differ when working on rebranding projects versus working on creating a new brand? And if yes, how does that work?
No, not really. Rebranding is usually prompted by the same impulses that initiate branding in the first place. It could be an economic shift. It could be a new competitor has entered the marketplace. It could be that we've grown or changed in a certain way that we now have greater capabilities, and that changes the shape of who we are in the marketplace. So all of those issues will affect whether one chooses to brand or rebrand. But basically, the protocol, the process is the same.
So you have a lot of brands that come from the same industry. How are you able to help them establish their unique voice and personality? And can you share an example of that?
Having experience with an industry and deeply within an industry, so you know it so well, allows us to recognize differences where others see only sameness. So what we've discovered is that if you're creating a brand, let's just say for an accounting firm, a lot of the work that they do is the same that they're going to do for any number of clients. In fact, much of it's regulated. But nevertheless, 3 to 5% is different, and the way that they deliver their service is different. That's what we're looking for, that those differences that we recognize, because we're not spending our time learning what they do for a living. We already know that. We're interested in what and how they deliver their service, how they approach their clients, and what they feel they bring to the table.
What makes legal advertising and branding different than consumer advertising and branding?
Well, if we agree that intangible services are more difficult to sell than those things that are tangible, we'll understand a bit more about the job that's ahead of us. Every tangible indicia of the organization becomes critical. In fact, becomes much more important than it should be. The business card becomes more important than it should be. The website, the collateral material, all of that gains in importance in a way that it should not otherwise have, because people have nothing to grab hold of and make an evaluation. Even sophisticated buyers of, say, legal services, honestly can't tell the difference between a pretty good and a really good brief. So they are making decisions like we are, and we all make emotional decisions 100% of the time. So we might make we'll ultimately decide, I like you and you like me. But the difficulty in really selling intangible services is that they're all relationship-based. So I've got to develop a relationship with you. So if I'm going to be involved in that with that law firm with a litigation in Kansas City and we're going to be in a motel for 2 weeks, then I really want to feel like I can like you and tolerate that. Otherwise, it's going to be misery for both of us. So developing a relationship is tough. So for example, unless there's a crisis, we'll go along with our regular dentist who just cleans our teeth. But if I've got a bigger problem somewhere in my mouth, then I'm going to start going to my Rolodex, asking friends, finding things in order to create a level of, in order to understand that I've got someone who is right, not only right for me, but somebody who will carry me through that tough time. So it's the relationship and the intangible knit together.
So how has the creative process changed over the last 35 years since founding your agency?
When I began with a pencil on a piece of paper, just like every kindergartner. And it was no different than that at the time. We worked with glue, we worked with pens. But today, we're really using, everything is done on a computer. We're really paying attention to different algorithms for trying to create relationship and engagement with folks. It's a completely new world. The technology has changed. If I tried to identify and enumerate every single piece of software that we've been through or every single piece of hardware, I simply couldn't do it. It would be the longest list in the world because the technology keeps changing, but the creative process does not. It's the same as it's ever been. We need to know our goals. That's the very first thing. So without a good understanding of the goals, we're not going to achieve anything. And then secondly, of course, is the creative solution itself. We want great ideas, not just ordinary ideas. People think it's very difficult for clients all the time to appreciate the quality of an idea, but great ideas make the difference. And it goes to the third point, which is great execution. With great execution of a great idea, with all of the goals properly outlined from the get-go, you're going to have a great creative solution. And that's the same from time immemorial, and it will be going forward.
How do you help your clients to realize the value proposition and importance of the brand promise?
Greenfield Belser is extraordinarily process-driven, and we bring our clients through our process as partners. In the end, if we have worked this process correctly, I often say if we jump over our own knees, we fail. But if we've brought them along and they understand step by step, every conclusion that we've drawn is a result of the research that we've gathered, as a result of speaking with stakeholders, as a result of getting client feedback about how they're perceived in the marketplace, we'll have a touchstone, we'll have an appropriate, proper place to begin. And from that, it's simply an issue of the execution itself, how the creative idea approaches. Now, if the conversation ever turns to, I hate red or I like red, we're done, we're toast. It has to be all about the strategy. The creative solution should, and I realize it's might be nuts to say this, but the creative solution should be less important to the client than we're on strategy. It's not about personal taste. It's about how we're trying to approach the marketplace.
What are the key areas for your clients to focus on while you're helping them enhance their customer experience for repeat business? And can you share an example, please?
Okay, our services are intangible, which means that they're hard to understand and hard to understand the process. Therefore, clients lean heavily on responsiveness, as they should. However, that's no longer a differentiator that will get you that repeat business because people have come to understand that responsiveness is really critical. Quality of work. We've talked about it's really difficult for folks to understand the quality of work can make a difference. Process improved, but could be for law firms and for consulting firms and accounting firms and others, the killer app. Because if I'm billing by the hour and I'm able to do what I'm doing more efficiently and more transparently, that's going to make me more appealing to someone to come back and forth. But you know what research proves? We've said no one makes a decision about anything except that it's an emotional decision. What we've learned is that actually likability trumps everything. So you are more likely to get that call back if you're likable or your firm is likable. There was a famous ad that you may have seen, and many people have it. It only ran once at a Super Bowl where a woman goes for Apple. Woman comes in and throws a hammer at the screen, and the audience was in there. They were robotic in the audience. They played that ad once. Everybody remembers the ad. Everybody who saw the ad remembers the ad. That's in effect likability. That's how you really reach deep into someone's mind. So folks that focus on that are much more likely to get those people returning. And that means that every element of your brand, every element of your own personality, all wants to really encourage likability.
Are there any guidelines that you follow to know what external communication channels are best suited for brands based on personality type?
That's another excellent question. The personality type has already been determined in our research, and then the personality type, what we're selling, where we believe our buyers are hanging out, is going to determine the channels. This is a quite deliberate process. We call it digital demand mapping, which allows us to understand where the conversation is going on online and what channels, particularly online, what channels we need to be using. The path to purchase is nonlinear. You yourself, I will may hear of something reading a newspaper and then go online to find it or capture something on my, or further investigate on my phone or go to a bricks and mortar store. That really, that pathway can't be fully predicted, but we can know an enormous amount about it and we can point the buyer into the right channels or find ourselves, more importantly, on the right channel ourselves where we're part of that conversation. This wasn't possible 5-7 years ago. This is very new technology that's changing the way we talk to our buyers, and it's very exciting.
What are the steps involved in conducting and preparing a competitive analysis while you're working on a brand strategy?
Obviously, the key is to get to know the competitor quite well, to understand what their brand promise is, as well as and how it compares to yours. To what degree is it arm's length? To what degree are we closer, side by side? And how do I need to differentiate myself, push ourselves further apart in order to really answer that question? But it's, I found it really interesting that in the end, you can have, and you will, have an enormous amount of information about a competitor, but it does not necessarily mean that that's valuable to you or useful. For example, if your competitor has 30 offices and you have 3, you can't compete on that basis. If a competitor has 500 accountants or consultants and you've got 7, you can't compete on that basis. So one has to take the strengths and speak to the strengths and show that to the marketplace. The advantage is of those 500 consultants in any one firm, probably only 7 or 10 are working in one area anyway. So to have that is to, if yours is a niche, then understand that niche and make sure your clients understand that too.
So in your book, 25 Years of Legal Branding, you wrote over a decade ago, what has significantly changed in the industry and how you go about creating strategies for your clients?
When we published the book, I was surprised to go to the Legal Marketing Awards and receive as a result of this a Lifetime Achievement Award. I'm the only one that's received that award, and I do believe it's because of the quality of the work that's in the book, but in addition to that, it is the history of legal marketing. It is the only go-to source where if somebody wanted to understand the industry that they're in, it's the only place that they could turn. So you have an important book at that moment and an important moment in my career. But it's interesting, I also, you know, you get a Lifetime Achievement Award and you think, well, that's it for him, he's out to pasture. But in fact, we've had a great run ever since because we are really continuing to pioneer. It's not just because I put something between two covers that says, my life is over, my career is over, or the industry has stopped learning, growing. It has changed. And it's changed in the way where the industry itself, it's a rapidly consolidating industry. So we're seeing over 100 firms a year merge, close in, close ranks, get bought by other firms. That has changed the landscape. So you're seeing super large firms that are competing on a different plane globally than a local firm, a regional firm, or smaller firms. You're seeing dramatic differences in the legal landscape that simply weren't there before. So things have changed, but if you really want to have a touchstone to go back to where things started, that's as good a place as any to go.
So what impact has social media and analytics had on your business model?
You know, social media has only been around for about 10 years. It's hard to believe. It feels like it's been around forever, but in fact, it's new to all of us. For many of our clients, they've been slow in the uptake. They can't imagine that it has a very important role. I even still get clients who ask if we need a website. If in fact, I don't even know how to answer that question. I don't know what to do with it. But a much more valid question for those buyers of selling, remember, sophisticated services. If I'm talking about debentures or divestitures or bankruptcy or other kinds or you know, or an audit, Is this subject to being influenced by social media? Is that something that I should pay any attention to at all? That's the question that a lot of our clients have had. And as a result, we've tried, but had difficulty getting clients to invest in that portion of their marketing and marketing channels that's changing. It's changing even as we speak. I believe that when we now know that, for example, content marketing is so incredibly important and we're trying to engage clients with our content, then yeah, we need to know what channels they're on. And they might be social, they might not be social. They could be very different types of properties. Nevertheless, they need to understand their place in that online conversation. This is new to them and they're beginning to wake up and say, yeah, that's a role we should play.
Okay, over the years, you've created hundreds of award-winning campaigns. So can you share a case study of one that was particularly challenging for you?
This is so much fun. Here's one. It's not at all what you might expect. Not the large campaign for which we're known, but a very small one. There was a Chicago divorce lawyer who asked us to help him advertise. We didn't like the guy. And really, yeah. That's generally...
Likeability zero?
Yeah, zero. Yeah. And that is the death knell for the creative for a creative team, because they do demand some resonance in order to succeed. But we had this wonderful idea, and the idea involved not just the creative approach to the advertising, but placement itself. So we placed ads in Chicago playbills and other places where wealthy people were likely to show up with their spouse or with their friends or others. And the ad said had a rose that had dried up and a petal falling off the rose. And the headline read, when the bloom is off the rose. And the copy below said, if your best friend is going through a divorce, please have them call us. It was a masterpiece of indirection. We did not tell them to, if we had actually said, you know, you're getting divorced, we know how terrible it is, call us, it would never have happened. But every woman, every guy talks to their best friend and says, I'm in a mess, I'm in a terrible spot, what do I do? It was brilliantly successful.
So what kind of response did that law firm get?
Oh, a tremendous response. And it was a, he was doing well anyway, and he did that much better as a response. And it a little bit burned us that we didn't like the guy in the first place, and he did so well. Yes.
What metrics do you use and employ to measure success of campaigns?
Well, we'd like our metrics to be increased sales, increased revenue. That's difficult to track. The path, as I mentioned earlier, the path to a sale is so convoluted. A law firm, for example, could do suddenly well because it hired an ex-governor or an ex-senator. That could change the landscape for them, and it would have nothing to do with the marketing that you had been, or put it this way, you couldn't necessarily automatically track that it was your marketing when you have that kind of input that comes right into the middle of your marketing program. Today, what we really hope is that we'll increase engagement with the firm. We'll get more people to listen in on a webinar. We'll get more people to show up on a seminar. We'll get more traffic on the website. We'll be able to track that customer journey throughout the website that leads them to engage, give their information and email in order to get more information about the firm. Rarely does it lead to a direct sale. Our goal is, as much as anything, is to get people this close so that the law firm could, or the accounting or consulting firm or university or association can get them closer, can get them all the way there.
Now, how do you stay one step ahead of the competition?
We haven't. Our competition is very good too, and I'd be nuts to say otherwise. But I do believe that people can hire us with confidence, because I believe that the quality of our ideas, the quality of our execution, our ability to research effectively and define the answers that we need that are going to guide a campaign or guide a brand are top notch. And I ultimately, clients don't know where to turn, and it's our willingness and our ability to reach out to them and cross the table and say, you know, you can find something here. I also believe that, and this is something that attracted us to Fenn Partners, the values that we have. They're our clients we won't work with, and we shouldn't work with. So we are driven by values. We're driven by a sense of fairness, a sense of partnership with our clients. We prefer not to be a vendor. We want to collaborate. So the goal is, if we're equals, we'll have a great relationship.
How do you balance the creative and technical aspects of your strategies with firms like Schwabe, Williamson, and Wyatt, who recently won an award in technology management category at the Legal Marketing Association Awards?
Let me slightly amend your question. We actually won all the awards, or we swept the category of websites for small firms, mid-sized firms, and large firms at this year's Legal Marketing Awards. And by the way, that's the...
And you don't do legal marketing. We don't only do legal marketing.
No, we don't only do, but that is a showcase for us. And in fact, that's the third time we've swept those awards. To your question, really the technical capabilities are not tough. The designing a website, that's not tough either. You want to do it beautifully, and you want to know both sides of the equation, technical and creative particularly as it interfaces with technology today in web development and design. But the real key, the hard part, is strategy, because the strategy will be catalytic to the firm. In fact, we see our work as catalytic. Schwabe, for example, has gone to, as a result of our work with them, is going to market based on industries rather than service areas. That's a big shift. That's a seismic shift in the culture of their firm. And yet, understanding that strategic approach and then helping them guide them through that, so that they're really, in essence, understanding why they're making this decision, the rightness of the decision, and the importance of it. That's the hard part. Technical, creative, we need to keep up. We need to stay ahead, but that's it.
So what makes your position vital to the growth of your company?
Absolutely nothing. I am actually completely unimportant to the future of our company. We have such spectacular people in place that have worked with me for 10, 12, 15, 18, 20, 25 years ago. It just goes on and on. They are extraordinarily talented. They know the drill. I'm just happy to be along on the ride with them.
How have you dealt with disruption in the branding industry?
We've been around for over 40 years because disruption is our MO. That's how we live. So many of my colleagues have not survived the shift from that pencil and paper I spoke of to the computer in the first place. Literally half of my colleagues moved on to other ventures, other professions as a result of that shift. They were unable to do it. The shift from technology to web development and the like. So what makes us successful is, to some degree, also what makes us different is that we embrace change. Every day I come to the office, something new is happening. And not only that, it's not just embracing change, it's leading change. It's helping our clients understand that they need to depend on us, they can depend on us to be their lighthouse for what's happening in the future. That's where we want to be. We want to be their guide.
What does the future look like for the branding industry?
First of all, I have no clue, but technology will play an ever-increasing role in what we do. Already we're surrounded by technology. Already we're finding ourselves capable of learning things and doing things that we've never been able to do. Amazon doesn't want to buy Whole Foods for nothing. They want the data. They want the ability to understand how to reach their customers. We're learning the internet is probably the greatest communications experiment ever devised by man. We are learning what sells and what doesn't sell. We are learning when it sells and when it doesn't. We are learning every aspect of how to approach a client. So will everything be reduced to science? I don't believe so, but I do believe that we'll find that science plays and technology plays a much closer role by our side as we create brands going forward.
How do you keep yourself updated with the latest trends in your industry, and can you share any of those resources with us?
I wish I could say there was a single place I go to for all the information that we need, but in fact, that's not true. I often go to CMO Council because they do research out of North Carolina. They do research that's constantly enlightening. IBM has an annual survey of marketers I find enlightening and interesting. But honestly, what keeps us up to date are two things. One, the emails that fly around where people have read here or seen that or heard that, and they're sharing that with everyone within the organization, and we decide whether we're going to pursue that or not. Now, what's really unique about us is we've had a lunch and learn, we call it Friday lunch, for over 25 years in our organization. Every Friday we're meeting together and we're talking about those things that we've heard. So we'll not only have individual speakers from within the organization, we'll also have group discussions around certain topics. It could be new developments in user experience. It could be understanding social media in a new way. It could be brand. It could be more general programs that have nothing to do with that, but just allow us to keep current with what's going on more broadly. We bring in speakers to talk to us and share their expertise that we really don't have. So for me, lifelong learning, that's a demand. I simply insist that the folks who work with us play a role in that. It's not a choice. It's what we do.
Burkey Belser, thank you so much for talking with us today.
Thank you, Tracy.
And that does it for this edition of Sartor TV. We hope you enjoyed and learned something new today. Until next time, I'm Tracy Fitzpatrick. Thanks for watching.